For this man, work is sometimes play. He's the president of a new contender in the home video game wars. The game he's playing is called Atlantis, and it's about to be introduced to the public. If all goes according to his plan, he stands to make millions. But this is a game full of surprises. This week on Enterprise, All in the Game.
I'm Eric Sevareid. If you weren't watching me right now, you might well be playing this, a home video game. That'd be a mistake, of course, but understandable. This year, Americans will spend $1.5 billion on game cartridges alone. Add the revenue from arcade machines and home consoles, and you have a $7 billion a year industry, one that barely existed 5 years ago. Until recently, the business was dominated by a single giant. But the explosion in the game's popularity and profits has drawn a dozen new competitors into the marketplace. This young and aggressive industry has now become a volatile one as well, where the stakes and the risks are high. This week on Enterprise, we follow a new company that hopes to stake its claim in what may be the biggest gold rush in the history of the entertainment business.
For Bil Grubb, a new Mercedes is not just a luxury, but part of the trappings of success in California's Silicon Valley. The son of a New York City cop, Grubb first came west in 1979 to work for Atari as vice president of marketing and sales. By 1981, he was convinced video games were a bonanza and that he should stop making money for Atari and try making it for himself. The result was a new game company called Imagic, with the 38-year-old Bil Grubb as president. He founded the company with three partners who had an average age of 28.
I finished my game.
I don't believe it. Brian.
Honest to God.
Brian Dougherty, 26, was a video game designer and engineer for Mattel's Intellivision.
Decided to drop out the dragon,
no, so I don't know what
we're going to do. We have to change the name of the game, yeah.
Jim Goldberger, 28, was a marketing analyst for Mattel.
In the latest issue of video games, just...
Dennis Kobel, 32, came with Grubb from Atari, where he was a game designer and supervisor.
Hi. $27.99.
What made the partners so eager to go out on their own? The industry's dazzling sales figures, expected to top $3 billion this year, more than half of it in software, the game cartridges themselves. The backbone of the business is a growing army of button-pushing kids who vicariously pilot spaceships, battle dragons, slalom down mountainsides, sack quarterbacks, demolish race cars, catch fish, or even bid no Trump at bridge. This subculture of video game fanatics is huge, as are potential profits, and Bil Grubb wants a piece of the action.
I want Imagic to be the best damn software company that's available in this marketplace. I want our people to have the opportunity to grow, to be challenged, and I think we all want to be able to participate in the riches that those things will afford us.
But to get those riches, Imagic first needed games. So Grubb raided Atari and Mattel for more game designers and set them loose.
This mothership, it's like orbiting around the Earth, but it doesn't have the fuel to land, and all these small ships are traveling down to try and attack.
Not another space shooting.
Brian, they sell.
I'd like it to be a space shoot 'em up. You just pick up the controls and start firing, but I'd like it to progress and have more and more options as the play progresses.
Well, as we all know, space shoot 'em ups really have been the hottest for the last year and a half. Let's take a
Most of our designers are in their 20s. Our marketing people are in their late 20s, early 30s. People have to, I guess, have a feel for that younger generation, for what turns them on, what gives them fun.
Oh, we're making this an Intellivoice cartridge, I guess.
I got to tell you, on this trip and stuff, we played B-17, and it's a kick. I mean, it really is. Mattel Electronics presents B-17 Bomber. It's really kind of...
It's no secret that I was working on voice when I was at Mattel.
It's a well-known guy.
Why did you do that, Brian? All right. But no, I mean, I think that's the most important thing, is that if we do a voice game, making sure that the voice is part of the gameplay and it's not just another just sound effect.
You know, all I can tell you is what a 10-year-old boy thought of it, and he thought it was absolutely terrific. I mean,
in January 1982, Dennis Kobel hit on an idea for a space shoot-'em-up game based on the lost city of Atlantis. In his version, Atlantis will be attacked by alien spaceships, which the player must shoot down.
It was such a natural, because everybody knows what Atlantis is. Everybody's heard that. That's good mythology.
The bulk of Kobel's early decisions about Atlantis are worked out on a computer. The game will have a limited amount of memory, and Kobel must juggle graphics, sound effects, and the gameplay itself.
Technologically, you can't always do what you want. You find that you don't have quite enough memory, or perhaps the graphics just don't seem to come out quite right, or the colors or the sounds, and you find that many times you have to make sacrifices in one area to get some other effect or something else in. At times it's very fun. At times it can be extraordinarily frustrating. And there's a lot of pressure, an extreme amount of pressure, because in any business that generates as much money as this does, there's the pressure on you to continue to produce one hit after another, and that's not possible.
After the preliminary computer work, Kobel begins to design the look of the game itself. By February, he has a primitive version ready.
These various blocks up here are going to represent the various alien ships that are going to come down and basically destroy Atlantis at the end of the game. Right now, I don't have the graphics for the ships yet, so I've just basically put in some blocks to indicate where the ships are going to be. And right now, they just kind of bounce from one side of the screen to the other. In the final game, of course, they will have much more realistic motion.
Okay, so these are the new Atlantis ships I've been working up.
Kobel's spaceships are designed with the aid of a graphic artist and a computer animator.
It looks like I'm going to have about enough room for maybe three or four actual ship pictures in the game, the way things are looking right now. That's kind of nice. That's really nice. That was moving very fast. That'd be really nice for, like, you know, very hard to hit, very fast-moving little ship. I like it.
Yeah.
It looks good.
Atlantis is basically a space shoot-'em-up, typically the most mass-marketed type, or oriented type games. In other words, you're going to sell two games of given quality level. If one of them is a space shoot-'em-up, another one is a strategy game, you're going to sell more space shoot-'em-ups.
And selling more games is important to Kobel. Designers get royalties on their games, up to 2% of gross sales. If Atlantis is a big success, Kobel will make a great deal of money.
You know, I stand to make an awful lot of money off of it, you know. Several hundred thousand dollars.
But Atlantis's competition will be fierce. When Imagic was formed, there were only three competitors to worry about. Atari was the first video game company and is still far and away the industry leader, producing both hardware, the systems the games are played on, and software, the actual games. Mattel, with its Intellivision games, is next, also producing both hard and software. But a revolution of sorts was started by Activision, a company which produces only the more profitable game software, which can be played on Atari or Mattel hardware. Imagic is trying to follow Activision's lead.
Activision is a $66 million company. They have a good deal of money in the bank. They have some sharp marketing and salespeople, so they are really our main competition.
Activision's success spawned not only Imagic, but a host of other companies.
You can see Spectrevision, U.S. Games, Apollo, Tiger Vision, Coleco, Parker Brothers, 20th Century Fox, Arcadia, Atari, Mattel, Activision. In fact, we even have a competitor that's right next door to us now, Data Age, as well as ourselves. We'll all be writing software for either the Atari or the Mattel system.
As some of you were able to see, there's a new company called Arcadia, and they're using a whole different medium to store the game itself, and that in itself is frightening to me. I don't know whether it's a death wish or what it is, but that now opens up the whole arena for piracy to start happening.
They're making it to work with any standard cassette. If they were to achieve any sort of significant penetration with the unit, they'd only sell one tape for, you know, every several customers, because kids are gonna, you know, take and make a copy over their friend's house. All it takes is an ordinary, you don't even need an expensive quality tape.
I have some real concerns as to what this company is doing.
Dennis Kobel's major concern is still Atlantis, which by March is beginning to take shape.
Okay, at this point in time, things are coming together really well. The cities have basically been positioned, as are the bridges and the various factories, and they're all positioned correctly, and I have the graphics in at this point. The ships are being launched, although the graphics are still being trashed out at times, which indicates I've got a problem I've got to fix. And the motion is starting to become like I envision it, but I obviously going to have to do some work on that still. Their shots are active, although they're not moving fast enough. I can see that right now. And they also don't come out right on the barrels of the guns, which means I've got to work on that a little bit. And then I think at that point we'll start to have a pretty good game.
Imagic's first three games are released in the spring. Within weeks, one of them, Demon Attack, proves so successful that Bil Grubb raises his sales goal for 1982.
Our plan for calendar 1982 was to do between $10 and $11 million. With the early shipment of product in March and April, we now feel very confident that we will be able to do at least $25 million in this calendar year.
Grubb's optimism is also fueled by 10 new games scheduled for summer release, including Imagic's first games for the Intellivision system. These 10 games will form the heart of the company's Christmas sales push. Leading the pack will be Dennis Kobel's Atlantis. In May, Kobel has a prototype ready.
Basically, you have bad guys or alien ships that start off in a high orbit, and basically they work their way down a level at a time. And when they reach the bottom level, they'll turn on a death ray and try to destroy one of your installations in Atlantis. And you have three bases by which you can defend Atlantis. There's a center base, which is your most valuable because it's easiest to time your shots to hit the bad guys. Or the side bases, which you basically have to shoot an angled shot. It's much more difficult. I give you a lot more points for doing that because it is more difficult. And we can actually go
ahead. By now, the game is ready to be played.
On the first wave, it's a wave-oriented game. The ships, they start working their way down. They're pretty slow, and basically I'm using the center base because it's very easy to hit them. And I'll use a side base here to get some of the shots. And as we progress through the waves, the ships will start to speed up. And as the ships, as they work their way down, you tend to lose portions of Atlantis. And what happens is I've got five installations here left. I'll let them go ahead and take me out here. As you can see, it gets pretty frenetic in the later waves here.
After development, Imagic's games are usually tested by kids while they're watched through a one-way mirror.
Okay. Big smile over there on that one. You like that? Neither one has looked to the other one yet. I mean, to blame the other one for missing.
Yeah, that's right.
Game's over, guys.
Okay, so what did you think of that game?
Wow.
Hey, that says it all.
Maybe,
baby.
What about you, John? What do you like about it?
I like the way it's detailed. Everything looks detailed and realistic.
We have them hooked.
If the game seems like a winner, the next step is production. The production process is a simple one. The brain of each Atlantis game is a microchip and circuit board, costing about $3. The chips have been manufactured with the Atlantis program built into their memory. They are then merely placed in plastic cartridges, and a game is born. The entire process costs under $5 a game. Atlantis will then be sold to wholesalers for $16. By the time it hits retail shelves, it will sell for $26 to $32. That's assuming, of course, that the game does sell. The first big test is in June, when Atlantis and the rest of Imagic's new line debut at the Summer Consumer Electronics Show in Chicago.
It's very similar, I guess, to bringing a Broadway show onto Broadway, and this is our opening night. And the reviews will be our critics and our customers as to how they will receive our product. So there is adrenaline that's been pumping since I woke up this morning. I wasn't able to sleep last night, and yes, I'm nervous. Everyone who embarks on such an endeavor like this, my palms are sweaty. I am nervous.
The show is the single most important event of the year for Imagic, when stores from across the country begin their pre-Christmas buying frenzy.
That'll be the video. I need an audio out, which is just an RCA.
Ah, damn.
The first night includes a nervous rehearsal of a presentation to the company's sales representatives.
Let me see how many lines I can blow. Once again, welcome. The 5 months that have passed since we last got together as a group have gone by very quickly. We promised delivery in April. We started in March. We said the product would blow off the shelves. The empty shelves speak for themselves.
The sales reps are then introduced to the new games. Across the hall, Grubb is ecstatic with their reaction.
Someone else came up and said it was like an inspirational meeting. I mean, he was ready to say, I believe!
Bill had him down.
All I wanted him to say is, yes, I'll sell! there are some things that I will say that everyone maybe thinks that they understand, but it's the most important 4 days we have in selling for the next year. Start to read name badges very carefully. The ones that we're mostly concerned with are the distributors and the retailers. There'll be a lot of competition there. The names of our suppliers are confidential information. We don't want to tell anyone where we're getting our packaging or who has designed our packaging or who we're buying our chips from. There are a number of brand new companies that are going to be in this business. Let them tough it out for themselves and let them go through the school of hard knocks that we had to go through.
The show is also an opportunity to find out exactly what the competition is up to.
I got a pocket full of quarters and I'm headed to the arcade.
Between 6 o'clock in the evening, late afternoon, you have a great deal of kids watching television then.
Business at the Imagic booth is booming, with Grubb doing much of the selling himself. For the buyer from Montgomery Ward, a chief concern is TV advertising.
And then a good deal of the older kids, you know, the 12, the 14-year-olds, watch Monday Night Football. So that's an area that we're looking at. We're then looking to go on Children's Network, which is Saturday morning. And there we capture a good deal of the younger audiences.
And the booth isn't the only place where business is good. Outside, in this motorhome, international sales manager Stan Peters is working foreign buyers, in this case, West Germans.
When you look at this, it's very difficult to distinguish what language it is. It looks basically just like a lot of writing. What do you think if we were to put here, just headline it English, underline it Francais for French, Deutsch for German.
In our feeling and understanding, we are around 2 years behind the American market in this kind of business. So we expect not an immediate great business, but in the next 2 or 3 years, a big business.
By the time the show closes, Atlantis's sales figures are star quality, with more than $4 million in committed orders. Imagic's total from the show is $24 million. That's for a company that originally hoped to do $11 million all year. So once again, Bill Grubb raises his sales goal.
We now feel very confident that we will do at least $50 million in calendar 1982.
Though the Chicago show was a huge success, there were some big fish that got away. Back in California, the Imagic staff reviews its failure to land the 2,000-store Kmart chain.
Their earnings have been going down over the last 18 months. Part of it's due to the recession, but part of it is they've hit maturity in certain markets and they are managing their inventories very carefully. So we really have to do a real hard sell on them. Once they see our commercials, and I think once they see
It's going to have to be a recognized national brand before they're going to be able to move on it.
Yeah.
Because he has to replace Atari product in order to bring it in at this point. They pioneer no new products, and we're not a nationally advertised brand today.
Well, we'll be spending $7 million on television from October through February.
I understand that. I mean, that makes us a nationally advertised company in October.
Can we somehow slide it up the organization? Is there anyone who's really into video games above his level?
Absolutely not. It is not a summertime thing. They look to get lean in the summertime. They know the sales curves, and they're most cautious about their inventory at this time.
It's so frustrating. I mean, we know we have some damn good stuff, and
yeah, he recognizes it.
And I don't know. All right, every 2 weeks there should be something that should go out, and I would like to be involved in that breakfast or the lunch meeting in July.
In late July, Atlantis hits retail shelves. Through word of mouth and packaging alone, the game begins to sell. Early reviews in video game magazines are good, and Imagic begins an Atlantis promotional contest. Within a month, the game is selling briskly. But September brings a new escalation in the video game wars, a sudden barrage of competitors' ads.
E.T. video game?
In television football, it's the closest thing to the real thing. Kaboom!
By Activision.
This is the arcade experience. We're ColecoVision. We
bring the early TV barrage catches Imagic by surprise and means that competition for commercial time will be fierce. Imagic will spend $2.5 million promoting Atlantis on TV.
So you created Atlantis for Imagic.
I was at Atlantis.
The skies above the underwater city filled with Gorgon attack vessels. Three sentry posts fought desperately, but they were no match for the Gorgon death rays.
But you're here. I thought the Gorgons destroyed everybody at Atlantis.
We did!
Atlantis by Imagic is for Atari and in television systems.
But Atlantis has already drawn a sizable following. By mid-September, even before the TV ads have run, Atlantis appears on Billboard magazine's list of best-selling video games. There is little question now that Dennis Kobel is going to hit it very big.
Oh, it's a good feeling. No, you know, it's a neat feeling. It's part of the, you know, kind of the American dream. You know, everyone wants to be successful. You equate money with success. That's what everybody thinks of, and we, a lot of us feel that inherently.
Though not as successful as Atlantis, Imagic's other new games are also doing well. By the end of September, the company has already done nearly $40 million in sales and seems likely to top even Grubb's $50 million sales projection. In less than a year, Imagic has emerged as the number two software-only producer behind Activision, and there is already talk of shooting for number one. Investor Frank Caulfield, who put $1 million into Imagic, is on the company's board of directors.
People don't like to be too overtly competitive, but I think clearly, as a director of Imagic, I'd like to overtake Activision. Why? Just for fun.
On November 3rd, Grubb assembles his employees. In a move at least partly designed to beat Activision, Imagic will make a public stock offering in December, the first software company to do so.
At 7:30 this morning, the Securities Exchange Commission received a registered letter from us with a registration statement requesting that we be able to sell our stock on the public market. What it really means is that it will give us the financial flexibility to be able to do a lot of things that we haven't been able to do in the past. It will give us an opportunity to have the recognition within the public of who we are. And hopefully it will give us all the ability sometime in the future to be very much aware of what our own personal net worth is.
Going public is also the first step necessary for the investors and the Imagic staff to take profits out of the company.
What was the opening price, Bill?
We're looking for an opening price in the $15 to $17 price range.
At an opening price of $15 per share, Frank Caulfield's $1 million investment 18 months ago could be worth nearly $50 million. How happy is he?
About as happy as I know how to be. It'll probably hit 100 million in sales faster than any company in the history of American industry.
There he
is. The mood of the founders is euphoric.
There was never any doubt we would be successful. I guess the thing that has amazed us all is the fact that we've been successful a lot faster than anybody anticipated. I mean, we figured we'd put in several years and that we would gradually become successful.
Bill Grubb's holdings in Imagic could be worth as much as $35 million. Brian Dougherty, Jim Goldberger, and Dennis Kobel could be worth about $12 million each.
What I would like to say here is to the four musketeers.
But 1 week before the public stock sale, Imagic hits a snag. Atari announces a slump in fourth quarter earnings, and Mattel says its Intellivision games will actually take a fourth quarter loss. The announcements cause a panic on Wall Street. The stock market drops 29 points in 2 days, and there is frenzied dumping of video game stocks. The negative climate forces Imagic to withdraw its stock offering. The setback is in part due to Imagic's own success. Sales of video games in general are still doing extremely well, but increased competition means that the profits are divided among many more companies. That's enough to create suspicion on Wall Street, and has at least temporarily soured all video game stocks. For Imagic, it means waiting for another day.
There really is a strong feeling of disappointment. But we tend to feel that as the market conditions settle, we will be able to make a public offering sometime in the early 1983.
But the setback hasn't stopped Grubb from continuing his search for the ultimate video game. Work has begun on a game based on hot air balloon racing, a sport as uncertain as any.
In a way, we're taking everybody into a fantasy world. And, all right, and if they're piloting a balloon like this, I think they, you know, they're very safe in the confines of their family room or their living room, but they really want all the excitement and the action of a thunderstorm and the possibility that the balloon can crash and yet they won't get hurt.